Hello everybody, good evening. I'm Cosmic Claire, and welcome back to one of my evening video blogs. Well, I'm sorry I've been away for a few days. Well, I've not been away really. I've been here all the time pretty much, but I have been away from the screens of YouTube for a few days, and this is kind of just winter tiredness and everything. I'm sure a lot of people out there are suffering the same thing. I kind of had a bit too much going on last week and kind of got the after effects of it this week. So I just really had to kind of chill out and take some downtime. Managed to get a few chapters of The Fellowship of the Ring behind me in front of the fire last night, which was nice. And yes, I've read it many times before, but I haven't read it since about 1996 or 1997, so it seemed a good time to get back into it. And this might kind of sound a bit tangential and peripheral and stuff to the kind of thing that I normally talk about, but actually, one of the things that this has made me think about is how we need to remember that we're human. You can't always, well, you can't always achieve what you want to, or as Mick Jagger would say, you can't always get what you want, but you might try sometime and you might get what you really need. And maybe I just needed a bit of time to step back and kind of look at things. Been kind of doing a bit too much and maybe starting to kind of get a little bit out of balance and a bit stressed and such like. So then is the time to realise that it's more important to regain your balance than keep on going. Even though you might kind of feel some kind of need or obligation to that. I think one of the problems is that we're so kind of conditioned by the social machine to continue carrying on with everyday routine work and task activities during the winter at this time, as the same as if you would as if it was July or September. And you know, it's just so important to remember our biological nature, our humanity. This is a very kind of depleted time of year. The light has begun to increase, and that's great. We're getting longer days now, but we've just had about, you know, we've just had 3 months of 3 months where we've never had a day with more than what is it, about eight? No, it's just come back to 10 hours. We've just gone past 10 hours of sunlight a day now. But those days around the solstice when it's like you're getting, well, 7.5 hours of sunlight, that's not a lot, and it's very depleting, and we've had that cold weather. And yet, the system that we live in expects people to be able to carry on like machines, and there is no compassion for human feeling. Productivity and efficiency has to be the same now. And this gets back to one of the things that I'm you know, quite preoccupied about, which is the loss of human values in our societies. Function, efficiency and functioning in an economic capacity are considered to be the only things that are of value in our society. And the fact that not everybody can function at the same kind of level of output and focus and control as some other people is a is a matter that people should be aware of, and yet people are considered, oh, they're a slacker or they're a weakling. I mean, we've had this thing lately, haven't we, whereby people apparently, I mean, it's been going on for a while now. I hear stories about people in wheelchairs getting attacked. I can't believe it, but I saw it somewhere. People being vilified. And it's really, really important to take a moment in yourself and think that we all have intrinsic, infinite value and worth as living sentient beings. And to go beyond that and not even respect that somebody in a wheelchair has probably more to deal with in certain areas than these economically functioning people is just kind of like a really important bit of perspective that we should have. So I find myself thinking, you know, how much are these people really being cooperating with a system that degrades human beings? I mean, we hear about people being turfed out of their houses and made homeless. It's degrading. And all these things take place as if, you know, it wasn't cold, people didn't have to eat, all these things just a matter of choice. And I think when the thing is that even these kind of people who get impatient and stuff, and criticize weak people, they are human and they are weak too. So one day they'll probably find that they are not quite as fast or as sharp or as strong as they used to be. And then they'll kind of learn a bit of compassion. I mean, we don't want to end up in a world like there was a movie back in the 70s with Peter York, was it, I think, and Jenny Agutter, called Logan's Run. And the society was designed to have everybody eliminated at the age of 35, because that was the year, kind of the age at which everybody, you know, kind of imagines that they get passed over the hill. And I have a friend who's going to be 35 any day now. And I can assure her that it's not a time of getting over the hill, even physically. It's probably a time when you start becoming more kind of settled in who you are and understanding of some kind of relationship with the world. So we don't want to get into this kind of. I mean, this is one of the downsides of youth culture. I mean, it's kind of interesting having kind of, you know, grown up as a child in the 60s and seen this youth culture, and you know, people of my generation, late baby boomer. I suppose we've kind of benefited from that because we've managed to be able to kind of keep a kind of like, you know, 60s or 70s youthfulness with us, and not think of ourselves as getting old in the same way as people did in the past. So now that, you know, people can still kind of seem young in their 60s and even 70s, you know, and sometimes even older than that. I know a couple of, really quite youthful 85-year-olds, and one unimaginably youthful 96-year-old lady, I think I've mentioned before. But this one, on the other hand, it can also kind of create too much of a kind of youthfulness culture where people kind of don't just act youthfully, but they kind of put too much on the strength and vitality of youth, which is a wonderful thing. But, you know, it's great when people still have lots of energy when they're old, but a lot of old people don't. And they do not lose their human value. And yet, one of the things I see emerging into the reporting on so-called healthcare and such like, and that is both in America and in this country. I wasn't going to talk about this, but I seem to have got round to it. It's kind of a logical extension of, you know, what I'm talking about, you know, feeling the frailty of our mortality. Well, in America and in this country, there was even a front page story on, I think it was Time magazine, about what's commonly becoming known as the death pathway in so-called healthcare. And what this is about is not about saying, oh, well, you know, some people are just kept alive on machines and has lost the quality of life and, you know, they're just being stretched out endlessly. No, it's, if that's all it was, it probably wouldn't be such a terrible thing. But actually, there is an entire movement in the so-called medical profession that actually believes that people, that patients should be actively encouraged to die. It's unbelievable. They should have water. I'm not talking about removing respirators for people who are in comas and, you know, being kept alive artificially, but elderly people just being, just having water withdrawn, so that they die of thirst within a few days. And this is being advocated, apparently, in this country. So this shows quite what a state the ethics of certain levels of our society has got to, and which is kind of pervasive in a small, subtle way through our work culture, where people are slave-driven, and, you know, this super trolley madness that they want to put on Leeds, in through Leeds. I'm staggered that some people want to support it because it's so good for the migrating daily work population, who really are just getting a more efficient, possibly not even more efficient, but a kind of more neatly packaged sardine can for their slave migrations to serve the corporate machine at the centre of Leeds. It's quite remarkable. So people are being turned into kind of just android functionaries to service this corporate machine. And one of the things I've been thinking about a little bit over the last few days while I've been kind of going through my own process of this thing, which I'm now about to talk about, is that there was a mention by Ron Van Dyke, who I'm a very great admirer of, about the concept of enantiodromia, which I came across in Jung. And so I kind of revisited the concept and had a thought about it. And actually I realised I was going through that process myself over the last few days. And what it is the it's kind of Western psychoanalytic way of describing the yin and the yang, which each of which holds the seed of the opposite within itself. So the great holds the seed of the small within it, and the small holds the seed of the great within it. And what this means in psychological or psychoanalytic terms in the Jungian psychology is that every mental state holds the seed of its opposite within it. And the more extreme that mental state becomes, then the more likely it is to manifest its opposite. So I suppose in this context, I would say, for instance, a good example of this would be the crueler a society gets, then the more likely it is to elicit compassion from its members, because slight, small cruelties can be kind of turned aside from and ignored, but gross and violent cruelties are so extreme that even insensitive people flinch and can't avoid acknowledging their presence. And we see this also in the economy, where the extremes of wealth and poverty are most becoming more extreme. So taking a little bit of downtime to sit by the fire and read Lord of the Rings was actually kind of a good way of recharging my batteries and finding kind of an angle to come back on this thing with. It also kind of touches on the theme of transhumanism, which I've mentioned a number of times before. And I think that this, what we see, this machine slave mentality that is being subtly and not so subtly infiltrated into our society, could be a precursor to a transhumanist agenda. I mean, you can well see, and that I think there are already people are talking about willingly taking implants because it'll, help them function better and all this kind of stuff. And this is a loss of humanity, folks. So I think it's really, really important just to, have compassion for ourselves and take it easy when you need to. And life is complicated. And we need to have a balanced life. You can get a little bit too focused on, outwardly directing your energies when it's important to balance that with inner nurturing, because we have to look after ourselves, we have to love ourselves, so that we can continue to be a light and carry our light as some kind of beacon into the world. So don't push yourself too hard, folks. Remember what's going on inside, and every moment is worth living, and it's about the journey as much as it is about the end. In fact, it's probably more about the journey than it is about the end. And as I say, means are ends in themselves, which is another way of saying that it's the journey, folks. So enjoy the journey. Be human and feel and experience it from the heart. So I think that's it for this evening, folks. Thanks for listening, and well, I will be back as and when the energy moves me. So thank you for watching. In Lakesh, good evening.